Let's start our ninth lecture. So last time I defined Riemannian curvature tensor by using this formula as a commutators of covariant derivatives, almost as a commutators of covariant derivatives. So this is the components of our curvature tensor, and it acts from the third power of tangent space to the tangent space. So there was a formula like that at psi zeta minus psi at zeta minus or plus, doesn't matter here actually, and here we should put a Lie bracket of this. So we see that our tensor, we have three vector fields and the result of the curvature tensor acting on these three vector fields is also a vector field. So what is the geometrical geometrical interpretation for this map? Imagine that you have manifold. You have some point on this manifold, and at any point on your manifold you have tangent vector, vector xi. Yes? And so you have it at any point on your manifold. The same is true for vector field eta. So this will be xi and this will be eta. What can you do? You can do the following thing. You can consider curves that have these vectors as velocity vectors at this point. So locally you can, roughly speaking, integrate these vector fields. So you find a curve such that its velocity at this point equals to eta. This is one curve. This is another curve. So, and at the same point you have the third vector field zeta. Okay, so what do you do? You consider the parallel transport. So this is just some geometrical phrase that you use to know this thing. So this is parallel transport of the vector field xi along vector field zeta along vector field xi. So you just consider this parallel transport as it was, for example, in differential geometry, the first part of the lectures. So you have some curve you have a vector field, and there was some statement lemma that if you have a curve and point on that curve and some tangent vector on at that point, there is only one vector field on the surface that is parallel and have that vector at that point. Well, you can consider a parallel transport of the vector along some curve. So this is almost the same, but you consider not a curve here. In this case, it will be just this thing. Yes. So as a vector field, you consider the velocity field of a curve. So this is almost the same. This is parallel. Transport of a vector field zeta along vector field xi. So you transported this vector field parallelly along xi, and you get some another vector somewhere here, for example. Yes, it will be xi prime. Then what can you do? Then you go from this point, you go along this curve that you get by integrating the vector field at this point. I said that at any point you have two vector fields, xi and eta. So from this point you go somewhere here, and or then you parallelly transport that vector, you get xi double prime. Then you go back. So you go along the curve that was that you get by integrating vector field xi, but in the opposite direction. So you go from this point to that. You get vector field xi 3 primes, and then finally you go from this point, and parallel transport of this vector here will be exactly r of xi eta z. So, and of course you should look at all this in infinity small, yes, infinity small sizes, because actually for example if the vector fields xi and eta, if they doesn't commute, if the Lie bracket is not zero, what would it mean at this point, at this picture? So forget about vector field xi, vector field zeta. You have only vectors xi and eta on your manifold, and you can consider this this contour. Yes, you go firstly by xi, then by eta, then by minus xi somewhere here, and then you go by minus eta. So what will happen if this Lie bracket is not zero? It means that well, there is very big and long story about all these things, but from geometrical point of view, it means that this point that you will came here along this infinitely small transports, it will not be the same as that one, the final point at when you will go by going firstly by xi, then eta, then minus xi and minus eta is not the same as the first one. Yes, exactly. It means that they say it means that this distribution is not integrable. It's some kind of words that you use in sub-Riemannian geometry and so on. So there is some different science. So exactly because of that, because you want to go back to the initial point, so after this all these four transportations, you want to go back to the initial point. That's why you should add this term here in the definition of Riemannian tensor. So, but for example, if vector x, vector field psi is the partial derivative along some coordinate and eta is the partial derivative of another coordinate, it means that their Lie brackets is zero. So if you go, if these curves, they are coordinate lines, it always be the truth that the Lie bracket is zero. But actually, if you consider some arbitrary vector field, it is easy to understand that the Lie bracket won't be zero, because you can move it slightly. Yes, you can multiply these vector fields by some function, by some scalar function, and this won't be true. So generally, if you have some arbitrary vector fields on a manifold, they are not holonomic. It's some another term. It means that their Lie bracket is not zero. So okay. So to get to be more precise, describe all that picture that we have here, this parallel transport should be very very small. You see, yes. So you consider this picture for some finite lengths of the sides of this parallelogram, yes. And then you consider the limit when the sides of this parallelogram goes to zero. Well, it is the most just like you want to define some derivative. So you must consider the limit of this parallelogram goes to this point. At the limit, you get exactly the Riemannian tensor. For example, on a plane, if your space is a flat, then of course, what will you have? For example, we have for our three-dimensional space. Imagine that it is flat. It is not curved at any point. What it means? You have two vectors, xi and eta, and then you have vector zeta. You can consider so the parallel transport of this vector along z will be the same vector zeta at any point. Yes, because we assume that our space is a flat, so it doesn't rotate anywhere because the space is flat. from the different point of view, if you will remember this statement about the parallel transport of a vector field along the curve, you will remember that there is a differential equations, some kind of that equals zero, yes? But for flat space, this is all zeros, yes? And these vectors should be just constant. It means just in a flat space, the parallel transports saves the coordinates of a vector. So it is just the same, but considered from the different points, yes? So it doesn't matter. Even you even cannot, you even can not to consider the infinitely small parallelograms. So then you consider exactly the same vector here, exactly the same vector here, and exactly the same vector here. So you see that the difference is zero, yes? So I said that when I said that the R of Xi eta is zeta is just the it wasn't the true. The true is that this difference here was Xi 4 primes, yes, and the result of the vector that acts on zeta is the difference of between that vector and that vector. In flat space, all these vectors, zeta prime, zeta double prime, and all of them, they will be the same. Riemann 10, they will be zero, yes, and the difference between Xi and Xi is zero. So, okay. So this is the difference between Xi 4 prime. I don't remember how I noted it there. So this is the result of 4 parallel transports and Xi. And we see that in a flat space, this is zero, and the parallel transport doesn't rotate your vector. So you see that the Riemann curvature, it's on this curvature depends how does, for example, geodesics on your space looks like, and many other things. For example, the heat propagation on your space depends on a curvature and many different characteristics and properties of your space depends on its curvature. Okay. So what next? Next, some properties. Properties. Bianchi identities. Hmm. А, ну да. Окей. How should you remember this identity? So you fix these two indices. And then in that indexes, this and this, you can see the, this cyclic permutation. This some standard play with with Christoffel symbols. So to prove this one, the shortest way is to find some coordinate system at for which. So you should prove this identity at a point. All these entities, they are tensors. Yes, this is a tensor. When you get a covariant derivative of a tensor, you get another tensor. So all this this sum is a tensor. If you will prove that it is zero in a point, it will mean that it is zero at globally. So you can find the coordinate system at which Christoffel symbols all vanish at this point. So I didn't prove it as far as I remember, but still it is possible. But know that it is only at a point. It is possible only at a point. So it doesn't mean, for example, that it is true in a neighborhood. So you should just consider some coordinate system at which this will be true. It is possible by counting some dimensions, some free parameters, and the number of equations. It is possible to prove that you can find a coordinate system at which this will be hold. So it is usually done just for make calculations shorter. At this point, the Riemann curvature will be the following. So this is only at a point. I want to emphasize this, that at this point x0, x0, this Riemann tensor components can be calculated by this formula. I remember that there should be some squares, yes, of the Christoffel symbols. And even in more general situation, when you consider the covariant derivatives not along coordinates but along some non-integrable vector field, there should be a covariant derivative along Lie brackets. But all this is zero because we find some good coordinate system, and what is left is this. And then just we remember that what is covariant derivative? Covariant derivative is a standard partial derivative plus some shift by Christoffel symbols. Christoffel symbols are zeros at this point. So the covariant derivative is equal to partial derivative, and you just should write all this down. So here will be the difference of two summons, yes? There, from there, here, and they all will cancel each other. Well, we can write this down. So what is here? Second derivative of gamma IMKJ. IMKJ. K, and here we have L minus second derivative of gamma A L, this is the first, M K, this is second, K, this is L from here, and J from here. From here, plus second derivative of gamma I m j, this is z along j and along l. Minus, so you see this is LJ, JL, so this is cancelled to this one, and so on. I don't want to continue. This is, so this is the main idea, is to find some good coordinate system, and that's all. Okay, by the way, in different notations, I will just remind you that this is just the same as that. And this is just the notation. So when you use comma and a dot, you usually mean the covariant derivative. If you use only comma, then you mean only partial derivative. Okay. Symmetries of the Riemann tensor. So this is in the coordinates, and this is in more invariant form. So geometrically, what does it mean? what picture should you imagine when you look at this? This is almost the Jacobi identity, yes? So you can see the cyclic permutations of these vector fields. Here you fix that coordinate. What picture should you imagine when you look at this identity? You should imagine the parallelepiped. It has three facets. So you can go along one facet, along another, and along third. It will be so. You see, yes. So when you go, so
isn't it GKL in the first term? It's into the cyclic permutation.
Here.
Yes.
J. Yes. So this is goes LK, yes?
KL.
This is goes, yes, And this goes here, yes, it's now, yeah, it's correct. So this is J, this is K, and this is L. Yeah. Yes. Now it's correct. Yes, it is true here. Okay. So what does it mean? So when you go along two different facets in your parallelepiped, yes. So you go along. And there you have that facet. So you consider the parallel transport of that vector along this facet, then you consider the parallel transport of that vector along this facet. And you get the parallel transport of this vector along that facet. It will be zero. Okay. Third R I L JK equals to minus R L I JK. So when you see this index down, you remember that you can put your indices up or down by multiplying your tensor on a metrical tensor. So equals to GI, for example, A MLK. So, and in physical literature mostly, you can see this. It is also some kind of notation. When you see one index up, you usually have some free space on the place where this index will be when you put it down. Yes. So in physical literature, you usually see these components. Here you have some empty space for that index, and then you have this MLK. So this is also, it is a question of notations. So you can put one index down by using the metrical tensor, and you will get these components, and this will be the true. When you put it down on this pair of index, there will be this Q symmetry. And the last one, by the way, in invariant, in invariant form, it will look the following. So you see, yes, when we multiply our tensor by metrical tensor, it means that we should, when we want to put it in invariant way, we should use these scalar products. Yes. Okay. And the last one. So you can intertwine these pairs of vector fields. Okay. So we have this pair and that pair, and you can change them. Of course, all these identities is true only for the Levi-Civita connection. Because here we use that that our connection is compatible with a metric, and that it is symmetrical, symmetrical or torsion-free. It is just the same that the Christoffel symbols is symmetric under the down indices. Okay. For example, let's prove the third one. What should it be? Zero. Yes, because it's just the same. When you put to prove this is to prove that R xi eta zeta phi equals to minus R xi eta phi zeta. Yes? Everybody understands it. Yes, because you can put here phi plus psi. Then if you have this zero, then you will have that phi is zero and psi is zero, and exactly what is left, it will be this one. Okay, this is a standard trick when you deal with some skew symmetrical apparatus. Consider this basic vector fields. Then what should you prove? So the Lie bracket of these vector fields will be zero. And what is left is just the commutator of covariant derivatives. And also we consider this I want you to remember that this is the scalar function, yes? So because this is the scalar square of this vector field, and when we were defining these covariant derivatives, we state that on the scalar functions the covariant derivative and the partial derivative, they act the same way, because scalar functions, they are zero tensors, so it is just the same. So and here when you put this partial derivative inside of the scalar product, you should put here the covariant derivative, because if your covariant derivative is compatible with this scalar product, you can, when you put your partial derivative here, you can put here a covariant derivative because of this. Okay, so this is what. Wait, it's not xi, it's zeta. Zeta. And what is this? This is j zeta. Zeta plus so the partial derivative, they commute on the scalar, they commute always because they are partial. Then you extract from this the dj di of the same. From the left hand side you will get zero, and from the right hand side you get exactly the difference of these covariant derivatives on the vector psi, and this summand will be cancelled. So yes, we used here that this connection was Levi-Civita connection. It sits somewhere deep, But still, this is true only for the connections that compatible with the metric. Okay, let's make a break. So what? Just here is some exercise for you. How many are there independent components of a Riemannian tensor? If you have four indexes, yes, and you consider your tensor on n-dimensional manifold, yes. So even you have all these symmetries, it should look like some constant multiplied by n to the power of force, yeah? So if it would be just one here, it means that you have no symmetries and all components are different and independent. Yes, but here you have some constant. Actually, of course, there is a formula for number of components of Riemannian tensor. How do you think what here? And actually, this is not an in the force. It is some. It's some n minus one n plus 1, probably, and multiplied by some n plus 3, or maybe not 1, 2, or minus 2. So, but the order, of course, is the n in the force, plus something. Yes, but divided by what? How do you think? 12. 12, exactly. Okay, 12. Next definition. Ricci tensor. So these words you hardly will see in some physical literature, because I don't know why physicians prefer not to use this, not to remember this guy. This is the definition. You just consider the, so some, in some books you see this Ricci or Rick. Some in other books you will see this letter R, but with two indices. So you can understand from that this is not a Riemannian curvature, but Ricci curvature. And this is just the convolution of these indices. So here we have summation under indices k. All right. This is the Ricci curvature, and it is under these indices, it is symmetric. It follows from these properties of Riemannian curvature. And the scalar curvature is the convolution of the Ricci. Also, you can find some different notations. This is a scalar function. This is all the same. Okay. So, for example, to build some bridges. In the first part of our lectures, we consider in the differential geometry. It means it was the geometry of two-dimensional, on the two-dimensional manifold. How many are there components of the Riemannian tensor on two-dimensional space? Only one, actually, because it will be just R 1, 2, 1, 2. And you can prove that this Gaussian curvature up to multiplying by 2 here you have this well-known, the determinant of the first quadratic form, yes. You have x1, you have x2, and you have no third dimension, only what you can parallel transport is some vector that is also tangent to x1 or x2, and you will get actually only so you can see the r e1 e2 e1 e2. You consider this parallel transport along that very small parallelogram. Here you have no choice because of dimensions, the Lie bracket of these vector fields will be zero automatically. You can see the parallel transport along this small parallelogram of, let's say, of vector field E1, and then you will get the Gaussian curvature up to multiplying of this divided by 2 multiplied by determinant of G E2. Yes? Or you can also So up to a multiplying of this determinant of the first quadratic form, because here you this is actually the R1. You have okay, this is some kind of you to get exactly the k, you should put one of the indexes up, but by putting it up you exactly multiply it by some metric tensor. Okay. So what is the main idea for here? The main idea is the exactly one component of Riemannian curvature tensor exists in dimension 2, which is independent. Any other either they are zeros, either they can be either they are this component multiplied by minus or some metrical stuff. So exactly what you have in this dimension is this component, and it is more or less the same as the Gaussian curvature. If you consider the, for example, if these vectors would be orthonormal, yeah, if you have this, if the coordinate system on your surface is orthonormal, then this will just will be one, and you don't have to pay attention on the putting up or down your indices. So okay. Also, there is something as sectional curvature. It is the following. Sectional curvature is defined by the pair of tangent vectors x and y, for example. So you have some multi-dimensional manifold and you consider two vectors, two tangent vectors in it, and locally you can actually it is not true, but okay, locally you can imagine that there is a surface that these two tangent vectors, they are tangent to this surface. Do you understand that? So if the Li bracket is not zero, then it is not true, but you can consider some projection and it can be done more carefully. So imagine that you have a pair of vectors and you can locally integrate them up to the surface that lies in your some curved space. Then the sectional curvature is exactly the this one. So it's up to this two. It is coincides with Gaussian curvature. So this is sectional curvature. You can understand or you can view it as a Gaussian curvature of a surface that has tangent vectors x and y as it tangent. Okay, yes. Actually there was a problem and still there is a problem of constructing some examples, some explicit examples of the spaces, Riemannian spaces with all positive sectional curvature. So for example, sphere is an n-dimensional sphere is a space where all of these curvatures, they're positive, because you see, because if you have n-dimensional sphere and two tangent space, two tangent vectors in it, the only what you can get is two-dimensional sphere. Yes, if you have some two vectors and they also have they are orthogonal and have unitary lengths. So there is always two-dimensional sphere that lies here and have these vectors that are tangents to this one. But there was a big problem to construct some different spaces that you can describe its curvatures, and these curvatures will be positive. For example, my scientific advisor in our institute, when he was a student, he found some the series of examples of these spaces. I think it was 13 dimensional double quotients of Lie groups. So you can see the some Lie group, and you have some subgroup here and another subgroup, for example, one dimensional circle, it is also a Lie group, and you can see the this quotient and that quotient, and finally using some calculus you can prove that on this spaces all the sectional curvatures they are positive. So it's it means that these questions they are not trivial, and it use some complicate algebraic in calculations to just to construct some spaces with prescribed curvature. But of course it's mainly the interest of mathematicians to construct some examples. Okay. Okay, so let's go to four-dimensional space. Let's calculate the number of independent components in this case. It will be actually 14. And yes, I forgot to mention that if you know all the sectional curvatures of your manifold, so you consider all the pairs of vectors in on your manifolds, and you know the sectional curvature of all the pairs of tangent vectors in your manifold, it means that you know all the all Riemann tensor. So there is very huge formula that you by knowing all of the sectional curvatures you can construct all the Riemann tensor. Okay, so what indices do we have here? 1, 2, 3, 4 or 0, 1, 2, 3. This is more preferable numeration because 1, 2, 3 is just space. Our spatial coordinates, and this is time. Okay. If we have two different indices in here, then what components can we have? Only this one, and pairs of these indices, they are AB, for example, so we have here six components of the following indices that looks here. It is, you see, yes? Is it clear what I mean? But we have here the pair of indices. The number of pairs of indices, it is 6. All the pairs that are when you change you because of symmetries of the tensor, you get only the dependent components. So here we have 6 components. Then if we have 3 different indices, so we have A, B, C, different indices here, and on that place we can put either A or B or C. So, and the number of the thirds, they are the following. What do we have? 0, 1, 2. 0, 1, 3. 0, 2, 3. And 1, 2, 3. Yes? This is all the thirds up to a permutations of the indices 0, 1, 2, 3. So here we have components 1, 2, 3, 4 multiplied by 3. So it is 12. 12. And also we have the case when all the indices are different. This is the case where we can write down 0, 1, 2, 3. But in that case, we have this this second property of the of the remaining tensor, and what is true, so R 0, 2, 3, 1 plus R 0, 3, 1, 2 is equal to 0. So they are dependent, and we have 1, 2, 3, minus 1 because of this, exactly this identity, so we have 2. 6 plus 12 plus 2 is 20. And what should we extract? From these 20, we should extract the dimension of the metric tensor. But the dimension of the metric tensor is equal to 4 minus 1 divided by 2. This is 6. And this is 14. Okay. So in our space-time, you should know 14 scalars, scalar functions to completely describe the curvature of the space-time. Now, about space-time. This is Minkowski space. Yes, Minkowski space. So I will be very, very briefly here. you have one time and three spaces coordinates. So the time is not space. It means that, for example, if you consider the scalar product of the vectors u with coordinates u0, u1, u2, and u3, and v, just the same, the scalar product in that Minkowski space will be the following. So you consider u1, v1 minus u1, v1 minus u2, v2 minus u3, v3. What is interesting here, if you consider standard Euclidean space R3 and you consider a sphere, two-dimensional sphere here, what is sphere? Sphere is all these points from here that its length, so it means the square, the scalar square of all these vectors from here equals to the one, yes? So this will be the space of the constant curvature, right? The same true for the Minkowski space. You can consider R 1, 2, and you consider here some sphere. Actually, topologically, it won't be a sphere, but we will show it just now. For example, this all the vectors, so the first coordinate will be t squared minus x squared minus y squared, and it should be equal to what? It should be equal to 1. Yes, by the way, there is different also notations. You can consider either scalar product as this one or as that one. So I'll put here plus or minus. But at any time we will understand what the right sign is. So what is that here? Actually, if you consider your space just as a space with three coordinates t, x, and y, it will be this thing. T will be here, x and y. When t equals 0, it is empty set. So it is called how does it called? Hyperboloid one. I don't know how it is in English. In Russian, it's однополосный. And in English, I don't know. But no, it's two двуполосный. Pardon my Russian. So you have two pieces, yes? There is a different equation for t squared minus xy minus y squared equals to minus 1, and you have this surface. And if you have here plus 1, then your surface breaks onto two pieces. So and on this surface, if you consider the scalar product not in standard R3 but in Minkowski R1-2, then you can calculate that the curvature of this surface is minus 1. It is almost the same when you calculate the curvature of the standard Euclidean sphere, but you can, what you should just remember, that the scalar product is calculated by that formula. For example, when you calculate this, the components of the first quadratic form, you should multiply R1 by R1. Yes? I'll put some formulas just to illustrate. For example, we want to find some good coordinate system in R1-2. T, X, and Y. R. Here will be squared here. So this is hyperbolic psi. This will be hyperbolic sinus and elliptic. You see that if you put this parametrizations here, then this surface will be exactly the surface where R equals to 1. Yes? If you put here in that equation. And then you go in by just the same. So you find the parametrization of this surface, you fix your R, and you consider the first vector. The first vector is R1. It means that you consider the d over d psi of this vector txy. Then you consider the second vector, and to calculate the first quadratic form, you should consider the scalar products of vector R1 by vector R1. But when you calculate the scalar product, you should use this formula instead of scalar products in Euclidean space. And then just the same, and finally you will get then, if you calculate all this stuff, the first quadratic form will have the following view. If I remember correctly, here we will have sinus of the here we have sinus, hyperbolic sine. Then you consider the about minus. When you consider the yes, the R2 will be sine with that minus. There will be minus, and because of that minus, there will also be a minus. So actually there should be minus here beside all this matrix, and here you have that one. So exactly it will be the metric of the space of constant negative curvature. I remind you that if you have curvature equals to 0, then when you put some polar coordinates on a plane, this is a plane, you will get this metric. If you have a sphere, then you get that metric. So R is just radius and phi is an angle on that circle. Here is also the radius that you go from a sphere on different points, and phi is an angle on the parallels, and r goes along the meridians. And when k is equal to minus 1, you get sinus hyperbolic r d phi squared. So this is the main examples of the spaces with constant curvatures. Okay, so Minkowski space is useful not from only from physical point of view, but also from mathematical point of view. You can draw some nice picture using that space. And what is left to do? So I want to actually, I don't have much time already. There are a lot of additional formulas. So probably it will be the next lecture, the beginning of the next lecture. So I want to find the Einstein equation to define. So we define this action, yes. The main idea is the following. So we have our four-dimensional time space, and we have some metric on it. What is g? G is the determinant of our metric. As this metric on the Minkowski time space, it means that locally these metrics can be written down by following way. So here now I put minus beside the time, plus dx dy dz squared. So this is the same formula for the Minkowski, yes, besides of the minuses. So here I will use the minus near the time. It means what, for example? That if you want to go, if you stay, I stay, yes, I don't move now in our time space, yes? So it means that dx, dy, and dz is zeros. I don't change my position in space. Yes, but in time space I'm moving, yes, because time is going. So if I don't move, if this summand is zero, it means that I go as a point in a time space, but only along the t direction, yes? Because my space coordinates doesn't change, and the length of velocity will be strictly negative. Yes, so I can draw this cone, well-known cone. This will be the time. This is the space coordinates, and when I stay as a space object, it means I go along the time direction with strictly negative velocity, yes? If you would be a photon, it means that your Actually, here I should put what? C, yes? Squared. The speed of light squared. So if you're a photon, the length of your time-space velocity is zero, yes? So, I don't know what to say else. If you're a photon, it means that you have zero mass, and exactly you're moving not inside of this cone as some massive objects like some particles or human beings. If you're a photon, you go only along this cone, yes, along these cones. And if you're a tachyon, yes, you can go in these directions. This is a time-like directions that is inside of this cone. The direction that lines on the cone is light-like, I think, directions, yes? And this directions is a space-like. But nothing material cannot move in that directions. This is some postulate of general relativity. Of course, we will think that the speed of light is 1. Here minus, because of that minus, because if you have some functions here, of course, this is zero approximation to our metric. We will consider some perturbations of this metric. Yes, that depends on some functions that will be written down here and here. But if you consider the determinant of that metric, you will have negative scalar. That's why we should eliminate, we should kill this minus and put minus here. Then we consider this square root. This is just exactly the volume form on the time, really space-time, yes, time-space. Of course, it should depends on the determinant of your metric, So, this is the most reasonable function to put. Yes, so as far as I know, Einstein wrote down his equations and he said that is very special equations and there is no action. So you cannot find an action. It means the integral of some function that by minimizing this functional you can get these equations. And about a month or so, Gilbert found this action. So actually, the most trivial and the simple what you can put here is a scalar curvature. And then by varying this functional, this action, you get some Einstein equations. There are just the following, Ricci minus 1, 2, Jij equals to 0. This is in the vacuum. So if you don't have any magnetic or any other massive fields. So this is the equation.
Yeah, the arrow should be there.
Yes, yes. Yes, scalar curvature should be here. So next time I will carefully find this equation and maybe not only for the vacuum space.